this as AV1 plus, sorry. So I can write A1 into V1, sorry, U1. A1 into U1 is equal to minus of AV1 plus summation I going from 2 to M of AI UI. Okay, I'm just taking all this to the other side. And I can divide by A1. Because A1 is not 0. Right, I can divide by A1. Right? So U1, I am able to write U1 in terms of the other vectors. Right? So U1 lies in the span of V1, U2, etc. up to UN. So because of that, the span of this and the span of this are the same. Right? Why? Okay, let's say why. If suppose something can be of the written of the form, say C into V1 plus C1 C1 U1 plus C2 U2 plus etc. up to Cm Um, I can write this U1 as this. I can replace this U1 in terms of this. So I actually get a summation in terms of just V1, U2, etc. up to Um. I just replace this. Right? Now at least it's clear? I hope so. Okay. So the span of this set and the span of this set are the same. Now we are going to do the same procedure. Okay? So now what we will do is, so we have this set. I will have to rub. What I will do is, I will look at the set V1, V2, U2, etc. up to UN. Right? Now I look at this set. This set is also linearly dependent. Correct? This set is also linearly dependent because this plus this is a spanning set. So this whole thing has to be linearly linearly dependent. So we get some summation of the form say A1 V1 plus A2 V2 plus B plus summation BI UI I going from 2 to M. Correct? Now, not all BI can be 0. Because if all BIs are 0, okay, and then what we will get is, we will get that this V1 and V2 are linearly independent. But we are assuming that this is a linearly independent set. Right? So because of that, not all Bi can be 0. Again, so there is some Bj which is not 0. Without loss of generality, I can assume that it is the U2 which is not 0. I will replace this, I can throw away this U2, just like I did earlier. Right? Now, if I keep on doing this, I cannot remove more than M elements. Right? At every stage, I am adding one element from V1 and removing one element from UI. Adding a VI and removing a UI. How many times can I do that? At most M times I can do that. Right? So the number, this N has to be less than or equal to M. So this is the proof that every linearly independent set has less number of elements than every spanning set. Okay? So that is proved. Now we can give an example of a infinite dimensional vector space. So an easy corollary of this fact is, any subspace of a finite dimensional vector space is a finite dimensional vector space. Why? Because what is a finite dimensional vector space? A finite dimensional vector space is a vector space which has at least one finite spanning set. Now, what is happening is, if you take a subspace and you take any linearly independent set there, that cannot be greater, the size of that cannot be greater than this spanning set we started with. So, V is there. V is a vector space. This vector space V has a spanning set V1, V2, etc. up to Vn. Okay? And we have W a subset of V. Then any linearly independent set of W can have less number of elements than N. Right? So because of that, this W will also have to be finite dimensional. So a subset of a finite dimensional vector space is finite dimensional. Voila. Now we can see an example of an infinite dimensional vector space. What is this example of an infinite dimensional vector space? Okay. So this infinite dimensional, what is happening? So let us look at the, I claim that the set of polynomials is infinite dimensional. Okay, so why is this infinite dimensional? This is infinite dimensional because 1, x, x square, etc., all these elements are linearly independent. So we are getting an infinite linearly independent set. We are getting a linearly independent set of as high a size as you want. So it cannot be finite dimensional. Actually, we cannot get an infinite linear, like in the sense, any subset is linearly independent, that's what you mean. Like any finite collection has that property, right? So 1, x, x square, so you give me a number, I'm giving you a set of that size, which is linearly independent, right? So how do you see that 1, x, x square, etc. is linearly independent? Is that clear or should I explain? So, okay, so basically what we are doing is, just look at, remember how addition was defined here. The addition was defined in coordinate wise, right? So what we are doing is, so suppose we have two vectors, two polynomials, say summation ai x power I and summation bi x power j. How we are summing is, we are collecting this ai plus bi and writing it as summation ai plus bi into, that is what you are doing. Right? So because of that, whenever you add something here, you cannot cancel anything. Right? So this forms a linearly independent set. So that is why polynomials is actually an infinite dimensional vector space. Now as soon as you have polynomials in infinite dimensional vector space, again we use this this theorem to construct other examples of infinite dimensional vector space. For example, C0, the set of our continuous functions, is an infinite dimensional vector space. Why? Because it contains polynomials, right? Because as I said, every finite dimensional vector space, the subspace of every finite dimensional vector space is finite dimensional. So suppose C0 was finite dimensional, that will make polynomials also finite dimensional. Correct? So because of that, C0 is an infinite dimensional vector space. Similarly, C infinity is an infinite dimensional vector space. So we have plenty of examples of infinite dimensional vector space. However, we won't be dealing much with infinite dimensional vector spaces in this series of lectures. We will be concentrating our attention to finite dimensional vector spaces. Okay? It's just to say, these are like how certain simple looking theorems can be applied powerfully to get some very cute looking results. That was the reason why I went into all this digression. Okay. Now, this theorem has another corollary. But before that, I need to define something. So let me define what is called a basis. Okay? A basis of a vector space V. V dot S means vector space. Okay? The basis of a vector space V. As a collection V1 comma etc. up to Vn, okay, is called a basis if it is linearly independent and spans. Brilliant. Okay, so such a set is called basis. Now, in future, we will generally be not just dealing with basis, but actually ordered basis. When I say V1 to Vn is a basis, rather than looking at the set V1 to Vn, I will most probably be looking at this tuple V1 to Vn. The order is somewhat important. You will see why the order is important, but not in this lecture, in the future, in the coming lectures, you will see why the order is important. So generally, I will look at an ordered basis. That means I am giving an order to this. Okay? It's not just random, like, it's not a collection of vectors, but it's rather a ordered collection of vectors. So they are called ordered bases. Now, I want to prove. So this is the definition of a basis. A collection of vectors v1 to vn is called a basis if it's linearly independent and spans. Now there is a nice cute theorem which is, I think, useful. I don't know whether you people know it, but if v1 to vn is a basis, okay, given basis v1 to vn, any vector v in v can be written uniquely as v is equal to c1 v1 plus etc. up to cn. Okay, this uniquely has to be underlined. Now, the fact that we can write V as a sum like this follows trivially from the fact that it spans. That's the definition of what it means to span. Correct? By definition. Now, uniqueness part. As obviously, as anyone can guess, the uniqueness has to come from linear independence. The linear independence. So, suppose, say, for example, a vector V can be written in two different ways. Say, suppose V is equal to C1 V1 plus, am I still writing small? V is equal to C1 V1 plus etc. up to CN VN, which is also equal to, say, D1 V1 plus etc. up to DN VN. Okay? What I do is, I take this to this side. What I will get is, I will get C1 minus D1 into V1 plus C2 minus D2 into V2 plus etc. up to Cn minus Vn, sorry, Cn minus Dn Vn is equal to 0. But the fact that these Vi's are linearly independent means that Ci minus Di is equal to 0, which is nothing but Ci is equal to Dn. So, as we guessed correctly, the uniqueness comes from linearly independent. So, why did we guess that it has to come from linearly independent? Because there are only two properties, spans, linearly independent. And spans clearly means this. So, obviously, it has to come from the other property. So, given a basis, we can write everything. So, in some sense, it's enough to look at this basis. Again, I will go back to it. So, remember this. So, in some sense, this element can be written as C1, C2, etc. up to Cn. So V can be looked like this. Okay? Again, I'm just giving glimpses of what will come in the future. So in some sense, this also looks like an RN. This is just an arbitrary vector space, but it has some kind of a RN-like looking structure to it. Okay, so that is done. Now what? Now I claim that, now the next thing. So given a vector space, I claim that any two bases will have the same number of elements. Okay, that is again, so given, so I have a vector space, so basis was nothing but a collection of vectors which is linear independent and spans. So obviously there can be more than one basis. Simple example to see is 1, 0 and 0, 1 is a basis of R2. Why is this a basis? First of all, I already showed that this spans. Why is this linearly independent? Because C1 this plus C2 this is equal to C1, C2. So this is equal to 0 implies that C1 and C2 are 0. Okay? Let's look at a more complicated example of basis. Yeah, I should give more examples. So let us look at R2 again. I am looking at R2. And I am looking at another example, which is 1, 1 and 1, minus 1. If you want to understand how it looks, this looks like 1, 1, and this is 1, 1, and 1, minus 1. Okay. So these two vectors. These two vectors are again linearly independent. Why are they linearly independent? They are linearly independent because if you take C1 this plus C2 this, okay, you will get C1 plus C2 comma C1 minus C2 equal to 0. This implies that C1 plus C2 is 0. That means from this you will get C1 equal to minus C2 and from this you will get C1 is equal to C2. Now this can happen if two elements, like if an element can be equal to the, if an element is equal to an element and equal to its negative, the only possibility is both of them are 0. Or if you are not convinced with that, what you can do is you can write this, you can substitute C2 here, can be substituted with C1, so you get C1 is equal to minus 0. So I'm just substituting this C1 equal to C2 here. So I will get C1 equal to minus C1. That means that 2 times C1 is equal to 0, that means C1 equal to 0. And the since C1 equal to C2, C2 also has to be 0. Right? So these are examples of basis. In general, actually, what in R2 it's easy, if two lines don't lie, are not collinear, that means if the two vectors are anything like this or say this, they will all be linearly independent. The only time they will be dependent would be they both, one is like this and another is like this. Or one is like this and another is like this. These are the only two possibilities where they actually, like, okay, this is one line, okay. So these are examples of basis. Fine. So now I want these things to be here. So I will write here. So is this visible to everybody? Or no? Yeah, it's visible. Okay. So now I want to say that any two basis has the same number of elements. How do I do that? I need this theorem for that. That is why I didn't run this. Okay. So now what we have is we have two bases. Let us say V1 to Vn and U1 to Um. Okay? So now this is a basis, this is a basis. That means this is linearly independent and this spans. Actually, both are linearly independent and both span. But first let us look at this is linearly independent and this spans. Because of this, from that theorem, every linearly independent set has less elements than every spanning set. So this implies that this is linearly independent. This spans implies that n is less than or equal to m. And similarly, this spans and this is linearly independent implies that m is less than or equal to n. Right? And these two together implies that m is equal to n. Simple? So any two bases has the same number of elements. This is called, so now we can define what a dimension is. Till now we studied what a finite dimensional vector space is, but we didn't see what a dimension is. So, since any two bases has the same number of elements, the number of elements in a basis is what we call as dimension. And hence it's well defined because of that theorem. Okay? So I have finished what basis is. I just want to discuss one or two extra points. I'll quickly do it. So, there are two extra theorems which I want to do. One is that if you have a spanning set that can be reduced to a basis, okay, so suppose say V1 to Vm is a spanning set. Okay? Then what happens is we can write it as summation Ai Vi is equal to 0. And sum Aj is not 0, right? Such that sum Aj is not 0. Okay? So you throw away that Vj. If you throw away that Vj, exact same reason we saw earlier. We saw this the same idea a little bit before, right? So since this you throw away that AJ and this is still spanning, and we get a smaller set. Now we again look at if that that set is linearly independent or not. If it's linearly independent, we already have a basis. If it is not linearly independent, there exists again some other element such that this the AJ corresponding to that is non-zero. Throw away that element also. This process has to end after n steps, right? Whether after n steps, everything will go, we are throwing away one after the other, everything will go away. So we will end up with after some time, we will end up with a linearly independent set. We started with a spanning set, and we will end up with a linearly independent set. So since that new set, at each point, we are not changing the span. So the new set is both linearly independent and spans. Hence, it's a basis. An important theorem. Second theorem is, suppose if you have a linearly independent set, you can expand it to a basis. Again, it's easy. Suppose we have a linearly independent, say, u1 to um. Suppose it doesn't span. Then there exists some u, okay, let's call it um plus 1, which does not belong to the span of this. Add that to this. Okay, that's the definition of it doesn't span. There exists some element which does not belong to the span. Add that to this. Look at the new thing. It will still be linearly independent. Right? It will still be linearly independent and its span is bigger. Now we check whether this new thing spans everything. If not, you add one more element which belongs outside the span of this set. Keep on doing this. This has to stop after finitely many steps because the vector space we started with is finite dimensional vector space. So it has a finite spanning set. So any linearly independent set has to be of size less than that. So it has to stop after finitely many steps. So you can expand linearly independent sets into basis and you can reduce spanning sets to linearly independent sets. I think I will stop here.